The title of this project is Elementary Neuronal Ensembles to Whole Brain Networks, Ultra-High Resolution Imaging of Function and Connectivity in Humans. I'd like to start by telling you the ultimate goal of this project, as well as some of the justifications that led to it. All the projects we have been hearing about, including this one, is in response to the first strategic plan generated for the Brain Initiative in 2014. This plan, titled Brain 2025, A Scientific Vision, identifies six high priority areas. Seventh calls for an integration of the first six. Number two of these six priority areas is maps at multiple scales and calls for coverage of from synapses to whole brain. This extremely ambitious goal was scaled back a little bit for the human brain studies and calling for imaging of neuronal ensembles, circuits, and larger scale networks, circuits of circuits, if you like. There was even a specific target that was given, which was imaging with 0.1 microliter or smaller voxel volumes. This translates into 0.5 millimeter isotropic voxel dimensions. There exist many critical reasons why such a resolution is important. I do not have time to elaborate on this, but suffice it to say that if the ultimate goal is synapses to whole brain, we are a long way away from it, even at 0.5 millimeter resolution. Nevertheless, 0.5 millimeter will bring major gains for studying neuronal ensembles that perform elementary computations in the brain. So, therefore, the overarching mission of this project is meet the Brain 2025 targets and achieve fMRI and diffusion-weighted imaging with 0.5 millimeter or smaller voxel dimensions in reasonable acquisition times and with increased SNR relative to the highest resolution data obtainable today, which is approximately 0.8 millimeter isotropic. I'm happy to say that this mission is largely accomplished. In our grant proposal, we have stated that cumulative gains through multiple technologies are mandatory to achieve the targeted resolution goals. The technologies that we focused on were image reconstruction and denoising, image acquisition, instrumentation, including going to a very high magnetic field of 10.5 Tesla for human imaging for the first time. I will show progress in all of these categories, but will primarily focus on the very top one, image reconstruction and denoising. In this category, the effort I want to talk about concerns suppressing the thermal noise in functional MRI. The experiment we employed to demonstrate this method is an fMRI study that used visual stimulation of either a foveal target or the region surrounding this target. It's a block design study as shown here, and we collected multiple 2.5 minute runs of this particular paradigm. With multiple runs, we can analyze either a single run or concatenate several of them to improve effective SNR and consequently functional images. You can see that a single 2.5 minute run doesn't provide very accurate functional images, functional maps of the particular stimulation paradigm. However, when we add three or five runs together, we can see the target, which is shown in red, and the surround, which is in blue, these activation areas showing up robustly in the images. With the image reconstruction and denoising method we introduced recently, which we call Nordic, you can actually achieve the same kind of image that you see in three to five runs in a single run of Nordic reconstruction, as shown over here. Most importantly, this is accomplished without image blurring. Here I show the voxel full width at half maximum before we actually, the standard reconstruction without Nordic and after Nordic reconstruction. So Nordic does not blur images. And here's a result from the second subject showing that. Here's another example. This is a 7T data acquired with the 7T Human Connectome Project protocol for a fast event-related paradigm with a face recognition task. Again, a single standard run is missing a lot of activation, and Nordic reconstruction provides functional maps equivalent to four concatenated runs. The method is generally applicable, although its effectiveness will decrease at low resolutions, where so-called physiological noise starts to dominate. But we are not interested in low resolution, rather at very high resolutions, like 0.5 millimeter isotropic, where thermal noise is dominant. Here is the 0.5 millimeter isotropic resolution data. The image shown is a single slice from an fMRI time series acquired using gradient echo EPI. The experiment used the same paradigm of target and surround visual stimulation I described before. With standard reconstruction, as shown here on the left, this single image reveals that SNR is too poor to provide meaningful functional maps. Nordic improves it tremendously, as shown over here. Again, we can evaluate the improvements by comparing Nordic reconstructed single image with the standard reconstructed image of the slice by adding multiple acquisitions together. In this case, I'm showing you 10 averages of the standard images. These images look very similar, as you can see, and so we are achieving approximately the equivalent of a 10 image acquisition of standard in the Nordic image in terms of signal to noise. In addition, you can appreciate in this very high resolution image that the image is not really blurred compared to the standard reconstructed image. When we look at the time courses, we see that for the standard image, we really cannot detect any kind of activation. But when in the Nordic, you can see the activation very clearly after the denoising of the Nordic. These are the images, functional maps that we have obtained from this data. And as expected, the standard image is very poor. Functional map is incomplete. But with Nordic reconstruction, you can see the target in red and the surround area in blue with the clear demarcation, a linear demarcation in between them on the flat cortex. But the beauty of this data is really appreciated in the cortical, not on a flattened surface, but on the real cortical surface. This is an axial sagittal slice showing the target and surround activation in the visual cortex. You can see that the activation follows the gray matter boundaries extremely beautifully. Here's a coronal slice showing the same activation, showing again the activation is restricted to the gray matter. And in addition, we see that we start observing differences across the cortical layers. And when we look at that quantitatively, we indeed recognize that the middle layers have higher activation, as would be expected from visual stimulation because of the thalamic inputs coming into middle layers of the visual cortex. And one more example. 0.5 millimeter isotropic 7T Tesla, bold, and vaso. This is 1 hour data acquisition. And you can appreciate that with vaso, which is a lower signal to noise measurement than bold imaging, that 0.5 millimeter isotropic resolution under standard construction doesn't yield anything. But with Nordic, you can see the activation very beautifully. In the bold case, you also see this very nicely with increased Z scores after Nordic reconstruction. It is interesting to note that at this resolution, the vaso images are starting to bold images and vaso images look actually very similar. And one of the major accomplishments Nordic can provide is in fact to elevate techniques like vaso, which is inherently poor signal to noise, into much more usable domain. The method also works for diffusion imaging. We have published this already, and I show you an example from 0.7 millimeter isotropic 7 Tesla data. In this standard reconstruction with this resolution, in this series of images, the tractography is very poor. The only recognizable tracks are the corpus callosum tracks, and the rest looks very, very noisy. But when we process the data with Nordic, you can see that now all the tracks are clearly visible, including the three-way crossings that are known to exist in the centrum semi-ovale. So far, all of this data I have shown were obtained at 7 Tesla using an industry standard commercial 32-channel receive coil, so-called NOVA coil. Thus, we have already met really the brain 2025 resolution targets at 7 Tesla. But a central goal in our project is to go to 10.5 Tesla for neuroimaging. Therefore, the gains we will get by going to 10.5 Tesla, which are significant as I will show you, will be icing on the cake, so to speak, or can be regarded as gains towards meeting the order of magnitude more aggressive goals set recently by the second Brain Initiative Working Group. Within this project, we have gotten 10 and a half Tesla working. And this is our most recent 10 and a half Tesla human head coil, which has 64 channels. Here is an SNR comparison at 10 and a half Tesla with our 64 channel coil versus 7 Tesla with the commercial 32 channel RF coil, the one we used for all the experiments I presented so far. Note that in this comparison, we have gains due to the magnetic field going from 7 Tesla to 10 and a half Tesla, as well as gains because of the channel count increase going from 34 channel to 64 channel. The data is presented with image volume segmented to peripheral and central regions with a boundary, the distance of which is varied from the periphery. And this distance is indicated by the parameter D. What you see is that in the central volume, there is approximately a twofold SNR gain at 10 and a half Tesla versus 7 Tesla. And this varies about 20% as D is increased. This agrees with expectations. Namely, approximately 32 channels captures all of the available intrinsic SNR in the center in human head-sized objects. Channel counts beyond that do not lead to further increases in central SNR. But higher magnetic field strengths lead to supralinear gains in the center, in this case, an expected factor of approximately 2 in the central region. In the periphery, however, larger number of coils are needed to capture the very high intrinsic SNR, and we have approximately 4 to 8-fold increase in SNR relative to 70 coming from both the increase in the magnetic field and the channel count increase. These are fantastic gains that will put us close to achieving not just 0.1 microliter voxel volume, but approach the 0.01 microliter voxel volume, albeit only in the cortex. Today, MR images are obtained almost always with acceleration, which generates spatially non-uniform amplification of the noise, the so-called G-factor noise. This is shown for the data obtained with a 32-channel coil at 7 Tesla. The G-factor noise is displayed as a maximum intensity projection on a sagittal slice. Red areas depict approximately 3-fold noise amplification due to acceleration in these images. When the acceleration is increased, as shown here, the G-factor noise also increases. By doubling the number of channels and going to 64-channel coil, the G-factor noise is reduced substantially, both in the center and in the periphery, and much higher acceleration rates are tolerated. We expect even higher gains with 128 channels. For unaccelerated imaging, the gains will be mainly peripheral, as shown on the simulations here. But for accelerated imaging, which is the real acquisition conditions, the gains will be over the whole brain. Therefore, we are in the process now, having completed the 64-channel coil, working on 128-channel coil development. Here are some progress reports on that. It's a section of the coil, a coil cluster with our homemade on-coil preamplifiers. You can probably appreciate the organization better in this schematic drawing, which shows the amplifiers and the coils together, and such clusters then will be tiled together to achieve the 128-channel coil. This project also has a head gradient development led by Brian Rutt at Stanford University. The goal is to generate this head gradient, which will achieve 175 millitesla per meter maximum gradient strength and 900 tesla per meter per second slew rate using the 950 amp drivers available from Siemens on the 10 and a half tesla. This gradient is in progress. Current status, the double layer Z-axis wires have been wound onto the mechanical support structure. Custom connectors, flow fittings, and rigid rungs have been inserted, and X and Y windings are in the process of being completed at the present time. So in conclusion, we have made quite a bit of progress, and in principle, original resolution targets has been achieved. We are now working to go significantly behind the original goals set out in this particular project. Thank you very much for your attention.